Welcome to Bible Tract Echoes. This program is the radio ministry of Bible Tracts Incorporated. Our mission is to take the Word of God to all the world. Our Bible teacher is the director of Bible Tracts, Pastor Mark Smith. Since 1938, Bible Tracts Incorporated has been publishing clear gospel tracts and supplying them to churches, missionaries, and individuals all over the world, and all at no charge. Information on how you can receive a free sample pack of our tracts will be given at the end of this broadcast. Now for our Bible study, here is our teacher, Pastor Mark Smith.
Good day to you, my friend, and welcome to the broadcast. Thanks so much for making us a part of your day. Now, right now, my Bible is sitting open to the book of 2 Peter and chapter 2. If you can, reach over, pick up your own copy of the Word of God and join me there. 2 Peter chapter 2, I'll begin to read at verse 20 here in just a moment. You may also want to get something on which you can jot a couple of notes. We really do try to make our teaching time clear, and you jotting some notes will help you review what we teach later on in the day, even perhaps sharing it with somebody else. But you'll also have that pen and paper handy to jot down our contact information. You see, I want to give you a free sample packet which contains one each of all of our English gospel tracts, and my announcer is going to provide that contact information at the end of the broadcast. I'm going to highlight one of the tracts here in just a moment, but let me lead into our teaching time this way. When I was a youngster, there was a television program on every week entitled Lost in Space, and I just thought, and everybody did, thought it was great stuff. But if you were to watch it today, you would think it, well, rather second rate, simply because the special effects back then compared to now just don't compare. Well, on the program, there was this robot, and his famous line, he repeated it often, was this: "Danger, Will Robinson, danger." Well, we don't have a robot with us today, but we do have the Word of God. And the message from the passage today is this: danger, Mark Smith, danger. And right now, I sure wish I knew your name. If I did, I would repeat that line, only I'd put your name in there instead of mine. The three verses before us today warn us of the danger of receiving God's Word and God's gospel, mulling it over, thinking about it seriously, only then to say no to it and walk away. The verses today do allow for some doctrinal debate, but more importantly, they confront us with the doctrine of danger. Get your Bible, join me, 2 Peter 2, also get something on which you can jot some notes. I mentioned the gospel tracts here a moment ago. And again, a gospel tract is simply a short written presentation of God's plan of salvation. The word track is just simply a reference to an evangelism tool. The one in my hand right now is the size of a credit card and by design. The gospel tract is entitled Charge It with a question mark. Charge It? Question mark. You know what a credit card is for. You purchase things, you charge, and the price is put onto your account. You must pay for it later on. Do you know how you and I are saved? Our sin is charged to the account of Jesus Christ, who is paying the sin debt for all who receive him. But then his righteousness is put on our account, and that happens when by faith we receive him as Savior. Now, the backside of this credit card track, there's not a lot of space there, but it's a lot said here. There are clear statements from clear Bible gospel sharing verses like this statement: "For all have sinned," and this statement: "The wages of sin is death," and this statement: "Not by works of righteousness which we have done, but according to his mercy he saved us." Here's this statement: "Who," speaking of Christ, "who his own self bare our sins in his own body on the tree." And then this one: "As many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name." Friend, this is a powerful little credit card sized track. It's effective. I use it when I go buy gasoline. I put my debit card in, pull it out, and I begin to pump the gas, but I slide this one into the credit card slot, and the next person who uses that gasoline pump must pull it out, and we have just put the gospel into their hand. I want to send you, let me do that, be ready when my announcer gives our contact information. All right, 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 20 says this, "For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled therein and overcome, the latter end is worse with them than the beginning. For it had been better for them not to have known the way of righteousness than after they have known it to turn from the holy commandment delivered unto them. But it is happened unto them, according to the true proverb, the dog is returned to his own vomit again, and the sow that was washed to her wallowing in the mire." That's the end of the chapter. Well, as I began the program, I said that these verses do allow for some doctrinal debate, and the debate is centered around the who question. Who is being described in these three verses? And you only have two options, really. Option number one is this. They describe believers who are truly born again, but they've been listening to false teachers, and they get drawn into the error being taught. If you take this option, you end up saying that the truly born-again person can lose their salvation and end up in hell. That's option one. Option two is this, that these verses speak about false teachers. But if you hold this view, then you have to figure out what verse 20 means when it says that these false teachers have escaped the pollution through the knowledge of Christ. That puts you in somewhat of a quagmire. Well, let me tell you where I'm at in this. Frankly, I think the whole chapter, and I know for a fact the whole chapter, is about false teachers. So I hold that these three verses are still focused on false teachers. So I have to answer the question, what about this escaping of this pollution? Oh, by the way, let me just say something here. There are some very, very, very godly Bible teachers over the centuries who take the other view from me on this whole issue. They believe that a born-again person can lose their salvation or, as they phrase it, fall from grace. Now, I have preached in some of their churches, and they know I disagree with them, but I went there to preach the gospel, not correct their belief system. Along the way, as we walk through these verses, I'll be using a series of words all beginning with the letter E, like in the word elephant. Jot down this one. The one we're going to use today is the word escaped. That's word number one, escaped. It's found here in verse 20. Again, verse 20 opens this way. "For if after they have escaped the pollution of the world through the knowledge of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ." Stop right there. Now, these false teachers have known truth and used truth to some extent to begin to escape pollution. But the end up, verse 21 says, worse off than they would have been if they had never known the gospel truth. How in the world are we supposed to understand all this? What does it mean that they escaped? Well, these false teachers, many of whom have grown up in Bible-teaching churches, they heard and they understood the gospel. They knew that Jesus' gospel frees sinners from sin, death, and hell. And these false teachers grasped the idea and the truth that the gospel of Christ was the key to escaping sin's, not only sin's eternal punishment, but the key to escaping sin's present enslavement in our day-to-day life. But let me right now give you a cross-reference that you're familiar with. If we were to turn over to Matthew 13, there we would find Jesus's parable about the sower and the seed. You remember the story there. You remember that some of the seed fell on thorny ground. There was four kinds of soil described. One was thorny ground. The seed went into the ground, a plant began to grow, but it got choked out by the thorns, which resulted in no fruit being produced at all. There was no benefit for the farmer that planted the seed. Well, the plant at first looked like it was going to produce fruit. It looked great, but it didn't. Only those plants in the good soil produce fruit. Now, there in Matthew chapter 13, Jesus explains the parable, and he speaks very well of only one of the soil types, the fourth soil, the good soil. In other words, the plant among the thorns is like a person who hears the gospel, begins to act upon the gospel message, they begin to enjoy the gospel truth, but they walk away from it. They never were born again. They just let the gospel affect their outside. They never got saved. Oh, they liked the message of grace and forgiveness, but they decided that the cost of belonging to Jesus was too high and too thorny. So they abandoned Bible truth. That's what these false teachers had done. Now, right now, let me just stop and make a couple of key critical notes. There are many false teachers today who teach a morality that looks a lot like Bible morality, but it's not based on needing Jesus Christ to be your Savior. Many mainline churches teach folk that Jesus taught us to live a clean life, and he did. They would be glad to teach and will teach the Ten Commandments, and they'll be glad to teach and do teach the pleasant parts of the Sermon on the Mount and so on. But what they will not teach is this. They won't teach that all people are sinners from the very top of their heads to the soles of their feet, and as totally sinful people, they have no goodness at all to offer God. There is none good, no, not one. They have no goodness by which they can bribe God to let them into heaven due to their goodness. And the churches that teach this will not teach that we all need Jesus and his shed blood to be the payment for our sin debt. They won't teach that Jesus' blood is the only means of being forgiven by God and the only means of having everlasting life. So, friend, I need to ask you this question. Are you trying to escape the pollution of sin? You don't like sin, you know sin is wrong, and you're trying to escape it, but you're trying to do so by living a high moral life. And you are living a moral life. You're living it in your own power, and nobody really knows what's going on inside of your heart, but outwardly you have a wonderful moral life. You're trying to do it that way, instead of this way, humbling your soul in repentance due to your sin, owning your sin, being sorry and repenting, turning from it, and receiving Christ Jesus as your Savior. Jesus is the only Savior. You cannot save yourself. Your religion cannot save you. Your baptism cannot save you. Your grandma cannot save you. Your morality cannot save you. There's one Savior. His name is Jesus. He paid your sin debt. You need to use his credit account and take all your sin, cast it upon him, and receive from Jesus Christ his forgiveness and his righteousness. He will help you live a godly life, but only after he becomes your Savior. Friend, if you've never received Christ, today is the day of salvation. Right now, cry out to him to be saved.
Thank you for joining us today for Bible Tract Echoes. If you would like to receive a free sample packet of our tracts, you can contact us by calling 309-828-6888. Our mailing address is Bible Tracts, P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. Again, our phone number is 309-828-6888. And our mailing address is P.O. Box 188, Bloomington, Illinois, 61702. You can also contact us through our website. Our web address is BibleTractsInc.org. Remember, the word tracts is spelled T-R-A-C-T-S. That address is BibleTractsInc.org. May the Lord richly bless you as you serve Him.